nobody knows what's around the corner. Life can be taken away on the turn of a sixpence. But as long as there are people who are prepared to come out of their door every morning and try and help other people, you have got to feel hope.
Hello, Queens. Oh, Jesus.
Adult and a trauma call.
Been stabbed twice in the chest.
Fall from parachute, hard landing.
Collapse on a football pitch.
Charge to 360. Excellent.
Thank you very much. Please call again.
Queen's Medical Centre, Nottingham.
Hey up, Ducker.
Another day in paradise.
One of the busiest A&E departments in Europe.
Wow!
That, I don't think, is survivable.
Have we got a new one coming in?
3 minutes.
There is no room at the inn.
Do you want anything to drink? Cup of tea?
This place is awesome.
A place where life...
Ding, ding.
You're a happy band of people here.
Love.
Love your kids.
And loss.
Chalk fruit and fruit.
Unfold every single day.
Working in A&E, you see people in those worst moments of their life.
My baby boy, I can't leave my baby boy.
But there are always stars in the black sky.
Oh, my darling.
It makes you realise how important life is, and we should hang on to that with both hands.
Love you.
Filmed across one 24-hour period, these are the stories of a nation and its health service.
Thank you for everything.
Oh.
Suddenly, a lot of the things that you thought mattered doesn't matter.
It's okay.
But you're there for me and I'm there for you. And that's a strong bond.
I'm loving you, man.
I'm loving you too.
Bless you.
Thank you.
I don't know why, but the Midlands, especially Nottingham, it's just very tight-knit. Everybody would help everybody, I think, if they could. You give somebody your last penny. That's just what's been bred into you. That's just the people we are.
Hello, Rhys's Lauren speaking. 21-year-old male. Thank you, bye. Can I have an amber trauma call for adult Rhys's in 20 minutes, please?
Motorcycle versus pole.
A 21-year-old man is being rushed to Queen's Medical Centre after crashing his motorbike into a telegraph pole.
Me and my brother have been through thick and thin. Growing up, we were always together.
Expecting them any time now.
On the day of the accident, me and my brother were just going to catch up, have a tea with our mates. I was riding behind him, because I always let him go a little bit in front of me. As we got up this hill, he clipped the curb. All I could see was this object flying towards the pole and flipping. And it was like all in a split second.
Are you going to do primary, Dave?
Yeah. Sarah's doing the access. Anaesthetics, major trauma nurse.
Zoe is the major trauma case manager on shift in Resus.
If a motorbike accident is coming in, then you are thinking worst case scenario, injuries.
Don't know what the speed was. His helmet came off as a result.
When patients come off motorbikes without a helmet on, it could mean that they've got a head injury, and depending on how severe, this can have life-changing effects.
They're suspecting a mid-shaft femur fracture.
Oh. He was screaming in agony, in and out of consciousness. The last thing I said to him, see you when you're in the hospital, bro.
Here. Hello.
I'm
Right, so this is Connor. Connor is 21 years old. He was riding his motorbike about 50 miles an hour when he's clipped a curb, come off, hit a telegraph pole. At the point where he hit the telegraph pole, his helmet has come off his head, then he's landed in a ditch. He's got obvious mid-shaft left femur, which is under traction at the moment. Total drugs-wise from us, he's had Entonox PRN, ondansetron 4 milligrams, TXA 1 gram, paracetamol IV 1 gram. He's had 10 milligrams of morphine and a total of 60 milligrams of ketamine.
Thank you very much.
No problem at all.
My name's Dave, one of the doctors. Can I have a look at you from head to toe, is that all right? Yeah. Pop your tongue out for me. Pop it back in. It's airways patent, it's trachea central. Any pain in your tummy at all?
The chest does hurt a little bit.
Yeah. Big deep breaths. Reduced air entry in his left side when compared to his right.
Pain-wise, is he settled, yeah? We've got access. We will go for a trauma scan, full one.
Yeah.
We'll go for x-rays of his femur.
So we're going to get you off his hard board, and then we're just going to slide you up the bed slightly.
OK. Ready,
steady, slide.
There's a lot on the line for the trauma patients. They can deteriorate pretty quickly. Can be a matter of life or death, and we want to get them in the scanner as quick as possible.
We got everything for transfer. Monitoring's on, CT and X-ray are ready for him whenever we're ready.
I honestly didn't know what to expect. I felt like I've already lost him once and I can't damn lose him again.
Connor's had emergency CT scans of his head and chest after crashing his motorbike at 50 miles an hour. Now doctors need x-rays to assess the full extent of his injuries.
They feel like his femur was quite angulated. It may be in quite a lot of pieces.
Me and Connor was born in Derby. Growing up, Connor was very happy. He was quite smart when he wanted to be, quite cheeky. But we was tight. I like tight as super glue.
Well, you're doing a great job, all right?
I couldn't ask for a better brother, better mum and dad, and a better family. We was always out doing lots of family stuff together, like going bowling, going to the cinemas, everything that you could imagine.
Are you able to do it today?
It wasn't till we was about 13 or 14 we started to realise that our family wasn't our real family.
Are you happy to live to your right leg?
Yeah. I think for mum and dad, it was hard to say when to tell us or how to tell us we were adopted. But they never stopped contact with our birth family in Derby. And I was just thought they were mum's mates or dad's mates. But they was actually my half-sister and my nan. Over time, we started to ask more and more questions like, oh, who's this and who's that? There wasn't an exact moment where our parents poured everything onto us, but little by little, they would slowly tell us this is what went on back when you was younger.
Done? Right,
hold on,
I'm gonna get you back.
It wasn't very nice to hear. It was awful. And it made me and Connor very distant. We pushed everything away. Even each other.
Connor is being taken back to resus while doctors await the results of his scans and x-rays.
You know what I did last time I was in a hospital? Played I Spy.
Do you want to play again?
Nah.
Oh, my God.
Let's have a look what you've done.
I was fishing, got a bait and you just stuck through my finger.
Oh, blimey.
How did you do yours?
I was doing the dishes and a bowl just, like, cracked in two and just
slit
sliced
finger.
It up, yeah. So it's an extreme sport doing the dishes.
Lisa.
Hello.
Let's get you in. Whee!
58-year-old Lisa has come to A&E after injuring her wrist.
Hello.
Hello.
So this is another Lisa. I'm Ali. I'm one of the nurse practitioners.
Yep. Yeah.
What's happened to you?
I slipped getting out of the shower.
Oh.
I was on holiday in Spain with my best friends. We were going to go into Tormelinos that day. So we was up early. Shell says, I'll start the breakfast. I said, right, well, I'm going in shower. And then I slipped.
The bath mat went one way. I went the other, hand against the door frame. I knew I'd done something straight away after I'd finished screaming and cursing.
Your hand flat against the frame, yeah. Like that?
We went to a clinic, they said dislocation, pulled it back in, which...
Some more colourful language.
I don't think I'll ever forget the pain. I put a splint on.
But it wasn't broken?
They said dislocated.
That's a really unusual injury. Okay. Gosh, right then. We need to have a look at it. Do you want to slip that off?
Fine, take it off.
When did you fly home?
Yesterday. But I still don't think it looks right.
No, I concur.
I met my friend, Michelle, in the pub. Where else? Nottingham.
OK. Are you able to grip my fingers? Not really. And relax, don't worry. Have you got somebody that's going to pick you up?
Yeah, I've got a friend. She's waiting for me. They wouldn't let her in, of course.
No.
I've known Lisa coming up for almost 6 years. We just clicked, and she's straight down to earth, calls a spade, tells it how it is. Just turned into a fantastic friendship. Wouldn't be without her now.
So, feeling down here.
I think she was drawn to me, if you like. She knew maybe I needed somebody.
Not too bad on that side.
No, it's fine.
That's good.
We've got pretty similar tastes in some music, but I don't do Bon Jovi. You know, she'll eat shellfish. I don't like it. And she wears some clothes that I wouldn't be seen dead in, to be honest with you. It's just little things that we haven't got in common. But I think at the heart, we've got our friendship. And anything that's not compatible doesn't matter.
You're not as tender as I was expecting with the amount of swelling you've got going there.
Ah!
That was the one?
Yeah.
I won't go back to it, don't worry.
No, don't.
OK. Have a breather. We need to get an X-ray, then we'll have a better idea of what's going on. I will be back with some pain relief.
OK.
So where were you on holiday?
Palladomina.
Is it somewhere you go to frequently?
I used to go to Tormelinos with my husband. He died 2.5 years ago.
Right.
So I took some of his ashes there. Me and Colin had many a nice holiday in Tormelinos. And every time we went, it would always be, when I die, I want some of my ashes here. Promise me you'll do that for me. Michelle said, well, you're not going on your own, you daft sod.
Right, codeine.
Okay.
Is two paracetamol.
Oh.
I must take this young lady round to X-ray.
That would be marvellous.
Pop my L plates on. It's been a while since we've been there.
...69-year-old Rob is in recess after the tube in his neck that he breathes through became dislodged, leaving him struggling for air.
What is it?
He coughed, a big cough, trachea dislodged. So managed to put shit back in, but don't think it's in place. Yeah, run you.
Nurse Jay is treating him.
A misplaced tracheostomy is a potentially life-threatening complication.
So trachea just needs checking it's in the right place.
It's not in the right place. The air isn't going to the lungs. And without oxygen to your brain, your brain tissue starts to die.
This is gentle.
I feel very protective of Rob. Very protective of him. Throughout that day, his tracheostomy was causing him some discomfort. So I loosened the Velcro and the whole thing came out. Everybody was panicking around him. Even on the phone to 999, I was like, just get someone here. He can't breathe. We thought this was it, he wouldn't survive. It was awful.
Hello, nice to meet you, I'm Jay. No. Do you mind if I have a look?
He's got locked-in syndrome.
In patients with locked-in syndrome, it doesn't affect their brain function at all, and they are still there. But you can't move your arms, you can't move your legs, and you can't breathe for yourself. They've got to have an open airway at all times, because if it's not protected and it's not clear, then that patient is going to die.
This is gentlemen.
A specialist ear, nose and throat doctor is checking Rob's airway after his breathing tube was dislodged at home.
What would you like?
Give him a second and I'll have a look with the camera through the tube.
Okay.
All right, so let's get the ambiscope.
Try and take it easy if you can.
His head bar, just relax. Have a look with the scope. Well done.
Are you all right, Rob?
I first met Rob about 12 years ago. He was a jet setter. Ghana, South Africa, Thailand, the Philippines.
He went pretty much everywhere. And he was a technical director for a large power corporation. My dad was a fantastic dad, really, growing up. Piggyback rides, you know, trips to the woods. Pretty much how I play with my children now. He was a very strong character.
I'm really sorry, sir.
He was a big guy. He was kind of like, you know, life and soul of the party. And it was hard to come to terms with the fact that he will never be the person he was before. It's quite hard to accept, really.
I'm really sorry, John.
Oh, Rob.
5 years ago, Rob had a brainstem stroke. That's when it sort of happens at the back of your neck there. So it stops all the signals going from your brain to your body, but there's no bleed on the brain to cause any brain damage. It's very rare.
Well done, sir.
We honestly thought he was gonna die because he couldn't breathe. All the muscles inside his body were just shutting down. They put him in an induced coma. And I remember the nurse saying to me, oh, we think he's got locked-in syndrome. Everything was negative, was scary, was frightening. It was really, really awful.
Tracheostomy is absolutely fine now. All right, it's in the right place. Yeah. Because he's got significant granulation tissue. Yeah. And that's almost blocking the airway. And we'll need to sort that out.
OK, thank you, guys.
When the stroke happened, I pretty much was only the daughter-in-law who barely knew Rob and was just there to sort of just support from the outside in, really.
You're right.
But then as time went on, things changed.
Hello, Risa.
Do you want the details? This gentleman has come off his moped trauma call.
Connor came off his bike and is being treated for injuries to his head, chest and leg.
Left femur.
Yeah.
Doctors now have the results of his CT scan and x-rays.
So we've done all your scans. We found that in your head, you've got some bleeding on the surface of your brain. It's just a small amount of blood, okay? We do need to speak to the neurosurgeon, which is the brain doctor. It'll just be us keeping a close eye on you in hospital. Yeah. And you've also obviously got that broken leg, which we'll need to put in a better splint, a bit like the one you're in, but a bigger one, just to get it in a better position before they come speak to you about fixing it. On that left-hand side, that lung is collapsed. Okay, which is obviously why you're struggling a little bit with your chest. So we need to get that lung reinflated.
A collapsed lung can be quite serious. If there is a lot of air in the chest and that's stopping the patient breathing, then we need to act on that pretty quickly, because if not, it can turn life-threatening.
We need to insert a tube.
What?
We'll give you some sedation.
A chest drain is inserted into the chest wall to reinflate the lung. It's quite a brutal procedure. It does make me cringe a little bit. I do feel extremely sorry for the patients when they're having it done.
When you've had your sedation, we'll try and attack your leg at the same time. Okay.
I'm coming at you from all directions, but we'll give you some decent stuff, okay?
Yeah. Give you a bit of oxygen, right?
You all right there, Connor?
The fact that he's allowing Kevin to wobble his femoral shaft fracture around.
So you can probably just crack on.
Bob Berfman must have only been about 21 or 22, maybe, when she had Connor and I. She had some mental health issues and quite severe post-traumatic stress disorder from when she was a child.
Sorry, Connor.
When I was 1.5, she commit suicide.
Lean in more. It's a lot of force. You just need to go harder.
Yeah. When we found out our mum and dad wasn't our real parents, we was crying, there was non-stop tears. There was a lot of rows. We sort of just gone off the rails.
Can you just have a quick feel? Yep. Karen can come out, yeah?
When we was about 16, we stopped going to school. We started drinking, getting worse and worse. And I don't think my adopted parents could handle teenagers being aggressive and stuff like that. I wanted to move by myself, whereas Connor wanted to move back to where our birth family was.
Okay.
My mum and dad just thought the best thing to do is just let us venture out on our own. So he moved to Derby, and I moved to Lincoln.
It's doing all the right things. Bubbling, swinging. And in the first few seconds, it's basically done 90% of its work.
There we go. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
How's your leg? Is your leg so comfortable now it's still? Too bad.
When are you planning on fixing?
It would be tomorrow. Now, I just have to tell you a little bit more about the operation. What the operation involves is putting a rod in the middle of the bone, OK? And that will help stabilise the bone. That sound all right?
I've been so used to having somebody there to joke with or make me smile, and it was like everything had just gone, and it was just me. It felt so strange. And then I found out over social media that he was on the streets, heavily an addict, like to drink and drugs.
Are you fish hook man?
Yeah, I am, yeah.
OK. Oh, my God. Let's have a look at you.
Where's that?
There.
How far is it in my finger?
Well,
oh, Jesus Christ, have a look at his finger. Look like he got way through the thing.
Let's not look at this one, just this one. So what we'll do, we'll numb your finger.
Just whack it out.
Pull it out.
Yeah, let's do it.
2 seconds.
Yeah, she broke it. Crikey, no wonder she jumped.
Emergency nurse practitioner Ali now has the results of Lisa's x-ray after she fell on a visit to Spain.
And she's had quite the uphill battle of late.
Is she back with us? Lisa, let's get you in and sorted. Did they tell you anything when you were in x-ray?
No.
Well.
Don't look good.
You've broken it.
All right.
So that bit there...
Yeah.
..should be straight up.
Bloody hell.
So it is slightly tipped back.
Yeah.
So I need to have a chat to my orthopaedic consultant friends. So they will need to move that for you again. Did they give you any kind of pain relief? What did they do to pull it before? They just yanked at it.
Mm. Oh, goodness.
Mm. Gosh. OK, we're not going to do that.
No, we're all breaking out in a sweat for you there.
Do you know how long this will be?
You're looking at about an hour or so.
Any chance I can go for a cigarette first? I know it's a naughty, bad habit. I don't smoke a lot, but I want one before they do that.
OK.
Well, considering what you went through last time, I appreciate you're going to be unnerved.
Yeah, completely understand. Go and calm your nerves.
Yep.
And then we'll sort you out.
Lovely.
Right, lovely lady. Encouraging bad behaviour, I am.
About 11 years ago now, I met my husband, Colin. It was at a local pub. His dress sense was atrocious. But he just got this zest for life that drew you. You know, I wish you could hear his laugh. It was so contagious. And that was it. I was hooked.
Come on then, cherub. I would say you can get a tan as well, but we're in the shade, I'm afraid, lovely.
We went to Benidorm for our honeymoon. He loved his holidays.
Right, darling, I'll wait round the corner for you. I'll come back out shortly.
No problem.
All right, Lise.
He loved to sit there outside a little bar, watching the world go by and totally relax. Hiya. It's broke.
Oh, dear.
I'm just downstairs. If you want to quickly pop down and come and have a fag with me. I was so happy. But then Colin had an accident on his birthday, would you believe? He went to sit on the bed and missed. And his leg hit the doorframe. So he went to A&E and they said it was broke. They were going to have to operate the following day. When he'd come out of theatre, he seemed OK. By day three, he's got a chest infection. But the antibiotics didn't work. And then we spent the next 3 days basically with him until he passed away. Just watching him decline. And the man I loved disappearing. Yeah. I'd lost everything. To me, Colin was everything. I was totally and utterly lost.
So where's it actually broke, man?
There. Michelle's been my rock. It could be about another hour and a half. I just wanted to let you know.
Yeah, it's fine, sweetie.
She didn't let me sit at home and wallow. And she called me from that. Pull me back if you like.
Let's get rocking and rolling.
I only put to Rose and Cran.
All right, sweetheart. Keep yourself entertained. Yeah.
I'll
thanks,
see you
sweetheart.
Later.
God, they stink. Send them to the incinerator.
Gosh, you're 90, it's beeping at you. Can you breathe a bit more or something? There you go, give you a rub and you go up to 91.
92. Oh, 93 with a bit more of a rub.
All right, let's do this.
Do you want me to get out of the way?
You're OK, you're not in the way, don't worry. So, sorry, Rob, I'm going to remove your tracheostomy. All right?
Dr. Mohammed needs to clear away tissue, which is partially obstructing Rob's airway.
Have you got silver nitrate sticks here? So, Rob, you've got some inflamed tissue here just around your tracheostomy side, all right? It's blocking the tracheostomy tube and it's causing you a lot of irritation and pain. If it's okay with you, it's just a small chemical burn, all right? And it helps just remove that tissue. It might sting a bit, all right?
You all right?
When Rob left the hospital, when he had the stroke, he got moved into a care home.
You're doing really well, Phil, right?
At that point, he was still so poorly. He wasn't getting the physio he needed. It was tough for Rob, it was tough for all of us as well. Our options were that he stayed in a care home facility or he came to live with us.
This is what's been hurting you at home.
Having my dad home is a massive relief, really. He's got 24-hour care, family on site all the time with him.
It's not hurting him.
He's never on his own. In the dark days, when it first happened, he couldn't move at all. But he's getting a little bit better every day.
Rob, well done, sir, all right? Rob, we're just going to change a tube for you, all right? And then once you've got a nice, clean tube in, you can go home. All right, sir. We're just going to get this trachea tube and I'll be back. All right.
Yeah, no trouble. Oh, that's better, isn't it?
Oh, you have such a lovely schedule. Laughing.
He's laughing because his trachea was hurting him. And I had a look, and then he coughed and it came out. So he's probably laughing, because he's like, well, yeah, she's really nice, except for the fact that she got me in this trouble in the first place.
When Rob first had the stroke, we didn't even know he could communicate.
Your arms and everything OK?
But he could look up and down at that point. That's how it started. We'd say, look up for yes and down for no.
Does it feel nice without it in?
We'd be able to say, are you in pain? Yes. Do you want some paracetamol? Yes.
Can I just sit here then and hold your foot?
Thankfully, my dad was what's known as partially locked in. The first little bit of movement we got back started with the toe. He would sit there in the bed trying for hours and hours and hours to get that toe to move. When it happened, it was amazing. It's only just a toe movement, isn't it? But that was the start of everything, really, for him.
As time went on, Rob came to have some lip movement, so we'd start to be able to lip read him.
Whiskey? Oh, gosh. I think I'll have one with you after this trauma.
Nothing's changed in terms of the way his mind works.
More? What, your foot up more? Too much?
He has a filthy sense of humour. And he'd always say things that are just so inappropriate and you'd be like, can't say that in here. And that's where you sort of see past his body not working because he still is just Rob.
Take nice deep breaths. How does it feel?
Why is everything making me want to laugh?
Okay, so I don't want you to look. Look that way.
Nice deep breaths. All done. Do you want to keep it or can I bin it?
I need it.
You need it?
I need to go fishing after this.
Well, pop your feet up, make yourself comfortable.
Lisa is being seen by orthopaedic doctors and a nurse to reposition her fractured wrist.
This is our wonderful machine. It looks a bit medieval.
So basically what we're doing now is we're trying to relax your muscles.
Yeah.
So then when we're trying to move it, things are a bit easier.
Now so I'm going to bring your arm up. I want you to bend at the elbow. So we hang there for about 10 minutes.
The trip to Spain was difficult. I hadn't been to Torremolinos since I'd lost Colin.
So I'm just going to do the plastering now.
We called in some of the haunts that me and Colin had been in. And then we went to a little bar. And I sat there for quite a while. And then I said, well, I'm going to do this. So Michelle got up with me because she wouldn't let me go on my own. You know, arm in a splint. Open the tub, out come his ashes. Just told him to go and fly. Do what you love to do. You're home. And walked away. Closure.
Are you
all
right?
Yeah.
We're gonna play tug of war now.
That's all right.
You all right?
So we're just going to wait for it to set now. You all right? Comfortable as can be, with three people hanging off your arm.
Yeah.
Feels hard enough to me.
Oh. Well done.
I don't think there's a day in the last 2.5-3 years that we've not actually spoken.
Hiya, I'm downstairs, I'm out. Yeah, I'll have a bit of something, yeah.
I mean, we talk about things that we wouldn't have spoke about while Colin was alive.
Well, there, I'll order a taxi. Eat a sandwich.
I think it's helping Lisa get over Colin's death. And if I ever needed any help, she'd do the same for me. It's just how people are around here.
The exceptional news is, as soon as this is done, Kat's got you some transport and we can break you out.
Rob is having his breathing tube replaced.
Right, so I'm just going to do a nice big suction and then we'll put that tube in, OK? Sorry.
My dad's stroke has brought us all closer as a family. The children get to see the granddad and I think the relationship between my wife and my father changed no end. I couldn't begin to put into words what Jenny's done for my dad and all of us, really.
At the beginning, my relationship with Rob was sort of a practical thing, but then I barely knew him.
Well done.
But now I honestly love Rob and I'd do anything for him. He's one of my best friends, really. We really are just, like, great friends.
I've got gel here. Just put a little bit in, just here, so it doesn't irritate. All right, sir? Just put the tube back in, OK? Well done. There you go. Thank you, sir.
Rob, well done, sir. All right, you did amazing.
Thank you.
Good man. All right, well done.
All right, cheers. Rob has got such a personality, and I think that's seen us all through, because he can just laugh.
Your chariot.
Yeah.
Oh, wait.
We can go home, Rob. I've never heard him say, why me? I've never heard him be down on himself. He's an inspiration, really.
See you next, guys.
Thank you.
Been a pleasure.
Cheers, thanks.
Yeah. Doctors have ordered another x-ray to check that Connor's lung is now inflated properly.
Alright, mate. My name's Tommy Zern. I'm here to take your chest x-ray, okay? It's going to be a hard ward line, but it might be a bit uncomfortable.
on it. We're going to try and push you forward slightly, yeah. All right?
OK, Connor, big breath in. Just do your best, OK? Hold it there. And breathe out, just relax.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah? Connor, we're all finished, OK?
After a year and a bit of living by myself in social housing, I went back to college. I sorted my maths and my English out. I'd saved some money. I'd managed to completely change my life for the better. And when I was 18, I reached out to my adopted mum and dad. At first, they were shocked, but they was over the moon. After a few weeks, we just got on again. We clicked like we were. And the next step was to get Connor back.
Connor, we're just giving you some fluids for you to drink, all right?
Me, my mum and my dad travelled down to Derby to just see if we could find him. I thought, Derby's a big place. But my gut was telling me that he's there. And amazingly, we was walking through Derby Town Centre and we found him. He was in this doorway with lots of other people. It was overwhelming because I hadn't seen him for a couple of years. I went up to him and I said, "Hey up, bro, do you know who it is?" And he opened his eyes and that, and he saw me. And he couldn't believe it. He was very skinny, very dirty. I was just so happy to be reunited with him. I didn't care what he looked like or what he smelled like. I'd still give him a hug. I said to him, "Look, come sit and have a Mackey's with me and my dad and my mum, and we can talk about everything, and we can change your life for the better." He was heavily addicted to drink and drugs at that time. Connor went through medical treatment for about 2 years. I made sure he was aware that I was there and I wasn't going anywhere again. And I felt like if I'm strong for him, he can get through.
My name's Lauren, sweetie. OK, I'm going to take you to the ward. Your mum is on her way. I spoke to her and told her everything.
Connor turned his life around. We all came back to live together. We didn't realise how much our mum and dad now must have loved us and cared for us. And it was that instant connection back together. We're together, we can do this.
It's early days, you know. Getting dressed, a nightmare. Still can't put a bra on. Saved me life. Just little things like that.
Get that salmon out, Con.
It's been 3 months since I left hospital and I've got full function of my leg. The next step for me and Shane is to get a flat together and to keep enjoying life. I feel very lucky to have my mum and dad and Shane. The relationship between us is unstoppable. We'll always be together and hopefully we'll be living together for many years to come.
Our home is a better home for having Rob here. He's got his communication aid, but my preference is still to talk to him directly rather than via his laptop.
A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z.
CRRI.
I had the best job in Ghana, with a nightlife some guys can only dream of. Then I go and have a stroke. I am retired, but only because I can't move a fucking muscle. I miss the physical act of walking through the seasons of the year. It's very lonely in the place I'm in inside my head. But I have the ability to go anywhere in my brain.
What's with?
Ask Grandad.
The grandkids are a constant source of joy in my life. My brain works perfectly. Probably better than before my stroke. I tell you, I'd rather be moving around. With plenty of time yet.